is no more. He was the tallest, grandest, and the first real hero of Bollywood. Joining me right now is Anjum Rajabali, the screenwriter of films like Drohakal, Legend of Bhagat Singh, Rajneeti, and Gulam. He's also my teacher. Sir, if I may ask you, how has Dilip Kumar influenced your life?
And I'm not merely saying this because he is gone, but because even during his lifetime, I have had occasion to actually mull over this question and, you know, recount to myself the what he meant in my life, even as a person, as Anjum Rajabali. One is, of course, as a kid, we used to enjoy watching his films. You know? So those, in my childhood, there were these three greats, which is Devanand, Raj Kapoor, and Dilip Kumar. And amongst the three of them, it was Dilip Kumar who was the favorite, followed by Devanand and then Raj Kapoor. I didn't much understand about performance or the nuances of that, but it was just very riveting to see him. I mean, obviously, there must have been, even at that time, what I was feeling is the charisma and the magnetism of it. I mean, he came through on the screen in a way which was very accessible. So that is what really drew me to that. I never really tried to imitate him, but I enjoyed listening to his dialogue delivery. And sometimes I must say that as a kid, I had to strain, okay, because he used to tend to go so soft. That, so you had to watch it again, you know, in the cinema, while there was no video or anything. So one is, of course, just to enjoy his performances and his films. Then began his comedy. That I began to enjoy. Then as I grew up as a teenager, of course, it was the tragedies. And I must tell you that between these three, the tragedy is what moved me the most. That, you know, because it used to make me cry. Then I have to tell you that as I grew up, became more aware of society, of politics, of Indian, you know, situation here and the underlying tensions, very often I heard him take a stand to speak publicly for secularism against communal elements. He never held any grudge against the people of Pakistan because he was also from there originally, I mean, from that land when that was part of India. And then when he was given, I remember, Nishane Pakistan, the Shiv Sena people, some activists gathered around his bungalow in Bandra West. And, you know, in the chaddis or something rather obscene and rather vulgar. And it is surely by by the grace and the dignity of his stature that without him even saying anything or protesting against that or speaking out again, arguing against that, it is that those people paled into Chichorapan. And you saw them as small people, okay, unable to in any way match up to them, no matter what kind of a drama you might do. So this kind of thing, that the restraint, because I was imagining that if I was living in that house, say with him, if I was part of the family, I would be very scared, and I might sort of even advise my, you know, elder relative, uncle, if he was that maybe you should be careful. Whereas he held his own, absolutely. So these things began to influence me also a lot. And I held him in high esteem as a citizen, not just as a performer. So we moved beyond that. And then as a screenwriter, Rukmini, when I joined in 92, there was one dream to write a film in which he would act. And I actually wrote a film about an old man, okay, who loses his son. And he goes looking, and of course there was the whole communal backdrop and stuff, so all that began to come in. And Mahesh Bhatt, I showed it to, narrated to him, we discussed. He was very keen. He said, no, we must do this. So he had in mind Dilip Kumar and Aamir Khan, and he said that would be an unbeatable combination, even though the Aamir Khan came. So it was even that as a professional, he was something that you aspired to have him in your thing, and the privilege and the pride of having written for him. And I envied people who had. I mean, Javed Saab wrote a couple of films for him, Kranti and Dunya and other I used to envy that I want to say this to my children and grandchildren that, you know, Dilip Kumar, I wrote a film, I wrote a role for him, and he said yes to act that. So that unfortunately never really worked out. And by the time I really got my act together with Rajkumar Santoshi, he was a little too old to be able to carry it off. So we let it go. So generally, I mean, it has been a very inspiring presence that he has had in this country and for me personally in my life, in my consciousness, that I was very glad and reassured and proud that there was a figure like that who never lost his grace, never lost his fortitude, never lost his dignity. Apart from, of course, his talent and the charisma which was there.
And it's also rare. I mean, often we, when we look at West, we often wonder, why don't we have stars who stand up for issues, stand up for, for humanity in general. And would you say Dilip Kumar was one star? He was definitely the number one of his time. I mean, and number one of many times for that matter.
Of all time, yeah.
So, do you think it... There has never been anyone like that after or before him, right? Who has taken a political stand, who has spoken against the Rath Yatra, he been attacked by the right-wing forces. Am I wrong in saying that there is...
No, these days, Rukmini, I will make a correction there. That these days, you do have younger stars who have been courageous enough to speak. I mean, you do have Swara Bhaskar, who does very openly speak out, and God bless her. And you have Richa Chadda and several others. I mean, even not just stars, but other people in the film industry, who in their own, at their own level, they're stalwarts. You know? So they have been taking a stand. But to have the stature of a super, super star, and to not feel fragile about that, to not feel insecure about your position being hurt, your fans become, you know, some section of fans getting resentful and might hurt your popularity. That kind of fear he didn't have. So in that sense, if you say a man of his stature, have we had anyone speaking out? No, I mean, amongst today's superstars, I'm sorry to say, you point out one to me who actually speaks out. I mean, at the most, there will be some extremely muted noise. And if there is any kind of backlash from some trolls, etc., they immediately shut up, pointing that out as an excuse. They look at this. How are we supposed to speak? Well, he spoke out when there were the Chaddi Brigade outside his house. I mean, making asses of themselves and trying to humiliate him, making a scandal out of it. He didn't bend. He didn't stop speaking. He held on to his values publicly and privately. So I'm afraid I'm not buying their arguments about fear. You know, that is the whole test. I mean, if it was so easy to speak, everybody would speak. Point is that when it is difficult, are you able to? Are you able to? So that he did.
What do you think would have gone into making Dilip Kumar? He was a product of partition. He was Yusuf Khan who became Dilip Kumar. What all actually went into making Dilip Kumar? And such great acceptance by Indians right after partition. I mean...
Yeah, but this is also, in a way, the tragedy of what has happened to this country. This country withstood partition with the biggest exodus in history and perhaps one of the biggest loss of life which took place and the enormous distress which happened on both sides. I mean, it happened to Hindus who came here. It happened, ironically, to Muslims who chose to stay back. Given that, this country was still open to accept, you know, people on the basis of their performance, on the basis of their talent, without necessarily looking at their religion. Much as I have to admit that Yusuf Sahab, Yusuf Khan was his name. So he did change it to maybe to make it more acceptable. I'm not so sure that he did it because there was a certain communal fear or a prejudice or anxiety that he had. It's quite likely that it was perhaps more flamboyant. He was a star, so therefore he needed something which would reflect that. Maybe Dilip Kumar, and you know, wonderful, we know him as Dilip Kumar, but we also know that he was a Muslim. So I would say that in terms of the force of conviction that he brought into every role, in life he must have been that. And if you look at his history and the partition, and he came from there, And the fact that there was still a certain connect that he felt with that, in his consciousness, maybe it was still one large country, one large set of people. I think all of that put together, plus the whole Nehruvian dream. I mean, Meghnad Desai did call him Nehru's hero, something, and the title was there. So there was a pro-people personal ideology that he had, which was, in a way, left of center. There was a socialistic thing. He contributed a lot to the distressed, the underprivileged, the victims of riots, and, you know, a lot of it which we don't know. Okay, I also discovered with surprise the magnitude of his support, that he would always rise to the surface. So despite the growing fear amongst Muslims and because of communal elements, right-wing elements, etc., he continued to hold on to his convictions. So obviously, personally, the man must have been like that. And yes, I guess the fire of his childhood and the displacement, all of that must have gone into retaining a certain strength of moral character, that you still don't hold resentment, that you had to shave, that you know, the people from your community are being targeted. No, he continued to remain a true blue, full-blooded, secular individual. That is a true Indian, in my eyes. That's a true Indian.
So, my last question to you, what's your favorite movie of Dilip Kumar's?
That's the most difficult question you could have asked somebody who is such a, you know, sustained fan and such a long-standing fan. I would have to name two, I'm afraid. Okay, not just one. One is Ganga Jamna, and the other is Devdas. Yeah, and. I must say, in both, one he was an external rebel, and one he was an internalized rebel. One where the violence was projected towards the oppressors, you know, at the risk of his life in the end. The other, the violence is interjected. But in both cases, there was the tenacity of his rebellion, which he carried off with human conviction. And I cannot weep, but weep at the last scenes of both. I mean, in Ganga Jamna, when he earlier, he had said to his brother, "Main ghar se beghar ho gaya hoon na." There, I mean, that sense of displacement, you see, it speaks of a larger personal pain, perhaps also of partition and a socialized response. I don't know, it's quite likely. But he says it with such deep feeling, "Ghar se beghar ho gaya hoon na." Then he's trying to explain to his brother, why is it that he became like that? So amongst everything else, that I was accused of this, and all of that paled, all that pain, which was genuine, but paled in comparison to that sense of displacement. And the last sentence he utters, when he's being chased by his brother, and brother says, "Stop or I'll have to shoot, ruk jao bhaiya." And he doesn't stop. And we don't know where he's headed. We think he's trying to escape, but he's headed homewards. He knows he's going to die, but he has to reach his home. And then he's shot. Nonetheless, he staggers on, reaches there. Younger brother, Munna, Jamna reaches there, takes him in his arms, and in his dying breath, he says, "Hum ghar aage, Munna, hum ghar aage." I mean, even when I say it to myself, I have tears, you know, behind my eyelids, you know, coming up. And likewise, the promise to Paro, and the absolute unwillingness, the dogged, tenacious unwillingness to let go of that love, which he knows is unfulfilled, and that was the epitome of unrequited, the tragedy of unrequited love, that no one else before or since has been able to play that with such deep feeling, such a fine texture which is so palpable, you can feel the anguish of that man, and yet the conviction in his love, and he goes and dies in her town because he promised her that I will meet you once before I go. No one could do that. No one could say, "Kaun kambakht bhool jaane ke liye peeta hai? Kaun kambakht bardasht karne ke liye peeta hai? Main to isliye peeta hoon ke bas saans le sakun." Who has been able to say that? There have been so many mimics, so many people who openly have said that we imitated. Mr. Bachchan in his early days used to say that. Shah Rukh Khan has said that. And many others haven't said it, but they definitely have been influenced by that. But those were all limitations. He was the original. And you know, shall I tell you something as a closing comment? I am not sad that he has died. I am relieved. And in that man was, I'm afraid in the last few years, you felt that he perhaps was living beyond what his dignity allowed him to. Because then to live, you have to do certain things, you have to dress up, you have to be around. Guests came to visit him, which I wasn't. I mean, I was feeling so uncomfortable and so resentful that no, you shouldn't, merely because you want a photo op with him. He's not in his senses. He's not able to interact, recognize you. Why are you going there merely because you want a memorable photograph of the man who you worship? Thank you very much. Keep him in your memory. Leave his dignity alone. Leave his dignity alone. Remember him as he was. Not, he won't want you to remember him as a person who's a helpless patient, not in his senses. You know, that is not right. But anyway, be that as it may, actually I feel relieved. And it's a good time to celebrate his life. You're right. Good time to revisit what an inspiration he was, and to affirm that there will be nobody like
him. Thank you very much. Exactly. I mean, resonates with, I think, many people in this country, that thought that there will be no one like Dilip Kumar again. He was brave. He was a fantastic artist, and he was a really good-looking man. So, what a Pathan, as one would say.
But even there, Rukmini, if you look at if you go by the conventional looks, say a Devanand, okay, or an Amir, he didn't have those kind of. Conventionally, he was not handsome, but was he an attractive man? Wow. You know, I'll tell you an adult reference. I remember a column of Shobhade, okay, and somewhere she had written about, and I think perhaps in a book, I don't remember. I remember reading the excerpt where he said, where she had said that for most Indian women, okay, who, I mean, sex was not necessarily a participative or a mutually fulfilling affair most of the time. I mean, it's just that the man wanted to take his pleasure off you, and the wife sort of allowed him to. I mean, that seems to have been the goddamn tradition. And she had said that for most Indian women, sex is about raising your sari and thinking about Dilip Kumar. I found that so perceptive and so imaginative. I mean, good for her, Shobha, that she could imagine that, yes, this is the fantasy that keeps them going. Everybody wanted him. So he was attractive because of his charisma, despite the fact that conventionally he may not necessarily have felt that. But now you use the word, as a woman also you use the word, that he was so good looking. So we have forgotten to measure him by any conventional standards. We found him attractive, and therefore he was good looking. He was handsome.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for your time.